So for this video, we've got two learning objectives. The first one is to distinguish between speed and velocity, and then to calculate an average velocity using the speed and velocity formulas. So let's distinguish between the two. So speed. First thing we need to know about speed is that it is a scalar quantity. What it is basically is a measurement of how fast an object's distance changes. So it's a rate of change of distance. We'll clarify this in a bit more detail in a second. Velocity, on the other hand, is kind of similar. However, it is a vector quantity, so that means it must have a direction. And what it is a measurement of how fast an object's displacement changes. So we need to really think about for a minute again the difference between distance and displacement. So velocity, we can then say, is a rate of change of displacement. So what do we mean by this? We're talking about a rate of change of distance and a rate of change of displacement. So let's start with speed first, which is a rate of change of distance. So if I'm walking and I'm taking nice big 1 meter steps, I'd say that my rate of walking is 1 meter per step. If I wanted that rate in terms of a time, and I was walking at one step every second, I'd say I'm going 1 meter per second. So that is my rate of change of distance, 1 meter every second. If I turn around and I come back, my distance is still changing by 1 meter every second. So my distance doesn't change depending on my direction, because it is a scalar quantity. It doesn't have a direction. Displacement, on the other hand, is a little bit different. So if I start walking this direction and I'm walking, still taking 1 meter steps every second, my displacement is changing by 1 meter per second. But if I turn around now, I'm going back towards my origin, so my displacement is getting smaller. So that means that my displacement is now negative going in this direction. So that means my rate of change will be negative. So I'm going to have a negative velocity going backwards of 1 meter per second. Because it's a vector quantity, it has direction. So it has positive going one direction, negative going in the other direction. So with that said, we can say that speed is the distance traveled divided by the time taken. So it's the distance per time. So we abbreviate that to distance over time, and then once again, we shorten that for the equation to d over t, whereas velocity is final displacement. Now, this is a tricky one here for displacement. It's probably more accurate to say change in displacement for that time interval, because we're talking about not displacement from an origin, because we're talking about the displacement during the time interval that we're measuring. So it's displacement over time, which we write as s over t. So let's do an example, nice real simple example to clarify this idea. So a Jamaican sprinter runs the 100 meter race in 10 seconds. Calculate his average velocity, right? This should be really straightforward. So velocity equals displacement over time, 100 divided by 10, obviously gives us 10. Now, what unit do we need to use here? And I've already previously mentioned this, but let's just clarify this idea of the unit. So we're obviously looking at displacement in meters and the time is in seconds. Now, we can't actually divide these two units to create a new unit. So what we say is obviously the meter per second. So we don't leave it as meter divided by seconds. It can be written like this little slash symbol, per second. That's a more common way you would see it in everyday life. But we're sort of looking at this from a much more scientific perspective. So the correct way to write it in physics is basically that seconds unit is being inverted and it comes to the power of minus one. It's the same thing as meter divided by second. It's just meters times a inverted second. Now, so our final answer there would be 10 meters per second. Direction, what is the direction? It doesn't give us any direction in this question. So if we were being fully correct in the way we wanted to write our answer, we would write in the direction of motion. Sometimes it's just implied, like this question probably would be, but if this was an exam scenario, I would definitely be writing in the direction of motion. So if we were to actually look at a 100 meter race, we would see that any of the runners here, their velocity actually changes throughout the race. So using that formula is clearly giving us an average throughout that race, right at the start, right from that zero point, they're accelerating up to their top speed. So there's two types of speeds and velocities we can be looking at. First one is instantaneous speed and velocity. So this is our speed at an instant in time. So for general purposes, we're talking about a really small instance in time. It's not infinitely small, but you know, basically that's what we're talking about, very small. And then we have average velocity. So this is an average speed over a period of time rather than a small instance in time. So if we look at speed cameras, traditional speed cameras, they measure your instantaneous speed. The problem with these types of speed cameras is that they only deter drivers from speeding at the point of the cameras. So what a lot of places have introduced is average speed cameras, and they can ensure that you're not speeding over a large distance. So how do they work? They work basically using the same formula. So here we have a region with two average speed cameras placed apart 10 kilometers, and the speed limit is 110 kilometers per hour. So let's take this driver for example. The camera recognizes it passing through at 9:23. It continues to move through 10 kilometers away. It's picked up again at 9:28. So 5 minutes has passed. So it's done 10 kilometers in 5 minutes. So if we put this into our equation of speed equals distance over time, we've got a distance of 10 kilometers. Normally I would be converting all these units to SI units. So I would convert it to meters and seconds. However, I'm trying to figure this answer out in kilometers per hour. So I want to keep my units in kilometers and hours. So I'm going to take that 5 minutes and I'm going to divide it by 60 to get it, give it to me in hours. So it gives me 0.08. So 10 divided by 0.08 gives me 120 kilometers an hour. Bam, this guy's speeding. And that's how it would work. Now, of course, a driver could speed at like 300 kilometers an hour and then stop just before the second camera and just wait it out a bit to extend the time that he did that period for. And good luck to him. But that's kind of pointless because, you know, most people speed to get somewhere faster, and that's not gonna do the trick for you. So let's have another example here. So car is traveling at 22 meters per second. It approaches a school zone and slows down to 11 meters per second. What is the car's average velocity during this time? So first thing I want to do is identify some of the units or some of the measurements that I've been given in the question to use. So firstly, we've got the 22 meters per second and the 11 meters per second. These represent our initial and final velocities. And you can see I've included the nomenclature that we use for this. So for initial velocity, we use the letter U. For final velocity, we use letter V. So as with any average, you get the two quantities, you add them together and you divide by how many you have. And that's the same way it works for average velocity. So I add the initial and the final velocity and I divide it by two. So I've got 11 plus 22 divided by two gives me a average velocity of 16.5 meters per second. Now, of course, I could actually ask another question with the same data and I could say, what is the car's change in velocity? I don't want you guys getting stuck on this because it's basically just as simple as it went from 22 to 11. So you get the final minus the initial. 22 minus 11 gives us 11 meters per second is the change in velocity. Finally, last thing I want to just quickly point out, when we're doing a lot of speed and velocity questions, one thing that often comes up is the questions are given to you in kilometers per hour and you need to give your answer in meters per second. So I just want to quickly go over how to convert that very quickly. So kilometers per hour, if we times that by 1,000, we're going to get meters per hour. Divided by 60 gives us meters per minute. Divide that by 60, we get to meters per second. Now, of course, that's going to work, but it's not really the ideal way to do this because you've done, three different calculations there. So a much faster way to do that is starting with kilometers per hour. If we just divide it by 3.6, we're going to get our meters per second. So there's no clever way to remember that. I just remember 3.6. And if all else fails, go back to the old way and just do it by knowing what your actual units are. So now, gents, what you need to get working on is that quiz. It's a pretty straightforward quiz. And I imagine that the vast majority of you with your good strengths in maths will push through that very quickly and find it not very challenging at all. As such, I've created a secondary quiz with extension questions. Bit of a disclaimer about it though, Mr. Till has said that my extension questions, and I quote, will make a grown man cry. So by that I take it Mr. Till cried when he attempted them. If you enjoy these type of problems and you have a good handle on your algebra, by all means attempt these questions. But don't get overly frustrated with them. It's very unlikely you'd get questions this challenging in the exam. That said, you know, that they do just involve the same formulas that we've just covered in this video. So they are within your ability to do. It's just that we wouldn't, we'd be very mean if we were putting these sort of questions in an exam. Like I said, they are challenging, so don't dwell on them too much. I will release a video very soon that goes through the solutions for these. So if you get stuck on it, just let it go and watch the video to see how I work through those questions. And as always, gents, if you have any questions with the content that I've presented today, please ask your teachers.